This is TWiT.
Bandwidth for KnowHow is brought to you by CashFly.
This episode of KnowHow is brought to you by iFixit. You've seen their teardowns all over the internet, the free repair guide for everything, and the ultimate marketplace for electronic tools and parts. For $5 off your purchase of $10 or more, go to ifixit.com/twit and enter the code KnowHow at checkout.
And by 23andMe, a personalized genetic service based on the 23 pairs of chromosomes found in your DNA. For Valentine's Day this year, give that special someone the gift of knowledge. Go to 23andMe.com and get $20 off when you buy before Valentine's Day.
Today on KnowHow,
Raspberry Pi gaming machines.
Welcome to KnowHow.
It's the Twitch show where we build, bend, break, and upgrade. I am Father Robert Ballas here.
I'm Bryan Burnett.
And we're joined today by this tall drink of gaming prowess, Mr. Jason Howell from TNT All About Android and Android
Soak
Apparina.
It in.
We are your
breathe
sponges.
It in. Whatever. Do I smell good?
Yes.
Breathe it in, Father Robert.
I would prefer not to.
We're totally not recording this really late and tired at the end of the day at all.
It's not super late on Thursday. We're not really punch drunk.
No. Don't apologize for me. No.
Don't put words in my mouth. Oh, but we're here for a special occasion, and we brought in Jason because this is something that's near and dear to his heart, something that you've done a lot, and something that I've always admired, and that is Raspberry Pi gaming machines.
Yes.
Jason, you reported on this on TNT. There was a mad rush at the end of last year for the mini Nintendos.
Yeah, I mean, they've sold like gangbusters. I can't remember exactly how many, with like 1.5 million or something.
Way more Nintendo than I ever thought they had any right to sell.
Exactly.
Nintendo thought, oh, you know, it's kind of a gag thing. And then like, oh my gosh, people are buying these.
Well, it turns out it filled a necessary hole that Nintendo had going into the holiday season. So it was really good. But I think it really points out kind of the value and the thirst, the idea that people who experience these games way back when are open to playing them again. And I mean, how long they stick with playing a single game, that remains to be seen.
Good point.
The first time you go back to some of those games and you play them again, you're like, oh yeah, this is really cool. You make maybe last like 5-10 minutes and get a little bored, but it's still really cool.
It's nostalgia gaming because you pick up the controller and like you kind of forget. You're like, oh yeah, I remember this. And like the mechanics start coming back. Mm-hmm. That's always fun. And I think it really does bode well that some of these old games, which by today's standards are hopelessly outdated. The graphics are horrible. The sound is horrible. Mm-hmm. The gameplay is horrible.
There's flickering.
They're still fun.
You lose lives. There's no save points. They're a lot harder, actually. You go back and you realize how soft we've become as gamers now.
That's true.
The unforgiving boss at the end of level 5, 6, 7 was, it was fantastic compared to what you deal with today in a multiplayer MMORPG environment.
And there were games back then that were kind of historic for their level of difficulty. And at the same time, like, there wasn't really no such thing as saving at a certain point.
Yeah.
So it was like impossibly difficult and no way to save. Therefore, like, and that's where kind of some of the stuff that we're going to talk about today actually ends up augmenting those experiences, because you can introduce things
save states and stuff
like that, and that actually makes the playability maybe a little bit better.
I remember the very first game I ever had where you could save a game was the original Legend of Zelda, because it had a battery inside of it.
That's right, it did have the battery.
And that was like, oh, wait, I can continue my game? Because I remember leaving my Nintendo on for days on end.
Yep.
When I had a particularly difficult game, I'm like, I ain't starting over. Because like even Metroid, it wasn't really a save. It was the combination of characters which would put you back to the same inventory.
Those were the worst, right? Where you had to memorize the password to get back to where you were. Like, there's a few games where it gave you, like, an 18-digit code, and you had to plug, like, write that down and then plug it in later if you wanted to get back to that point in the game.
It wasn't that difficult because they gave you a couple of pages in the back of the manual on which to write it in. Right. So, see, they gave you the tools that you needed.
There were a couple of times when I was playing Metroid where, you know, it'd be a late-night session. I write my save code down. I come back the next morning and I type it in, and it was, like, incorrect.
Oh no!
Which one was it? You know, which, and then you have to go back to the last date. And it's like, oh my gosh! Yeah. So thankfully, that's gone. We're not here to talk about nostalgia gaming. No, we're here to talk about what we can do with the Raspi.
Mm-hmm. That's right. But nostalgia gaming is what got us into this project, because I remember when the first Raspberry Pi got announced, which is this little guy.
That's the one.
This is the first Raspberry Pi I ever got. Full SD card, put in this little wood case. Yeah, I know. Look at that.
It's so cute.
So old school now.
Yeah.
But when I had been excited about the Raspberry Pi, but then you get it and you're like, all right, what's the first project I do? And of course, my mind went straight to, I want to do an emulation machine, because the, you know, all those old hardware consoles, like, they weren't that powerful, and the Pi like fit into that perfectly if you wanted to put it in a different case or you wanted to run like multiple emulators and stuff. But how far we have come, not only in the, say, hardware from the first Raspberry Pi, but to where the software is now.
Oh yeah.
It's too easy, actually.
So on the first one, when you kind of went into emulation on the Raspberry Pi 1, before the community around this stuff was as built up as it is now.
Right.
I mean, I know with the 2 and the 3, getting emulation running on those is as simple as download the image, have the right size flash drive, pop it on there, plug it in, and you're golden. Like, you're going. Was it that easy with the 1, or was it a lot more complicated?
No. Like, yeah.
It's like in the 50s, the episode 50s of KnowHow, where you know there were so many steps, because you had to get the image first, and then you had to find the ROMs that you could add to the image.
Everything was a pain.
And if you made one step wrong, it was easier just to go wipe the card, start over.
I did it three or four times where I wiped the card and did it. And it was a lot harder to do. It was KnowHow, like, episode 83. It was, like, one of the first projects I did. And the list of steps that I did, I was like, oh, this is ridiculous. Like, it was 2 pages long. And then I was like, I should make a new video for the update for, like, this episode that we're doing. And I was like, it's so easy now that I'm not even going to bother. It's, like, 3 steps now. But, yeah, it was a lot harder. Updating was a pain. I had to go into XML files to edit the data for the game so I knew which game was which. So I put, like, I had to go find pictures for them. I had to, like, get the details, the description, all that stuff. But, like, the Raspberry Pi 1 was powerful enough to do all the, like, NES, Super NES, Genesis, and I put it into this NES case. And if you go to the product shop, by the way,
the people still love this. When they come by and they see this, and you know they think, oh, it's just a decoration. You tell them, no, it actually plays games.
It does.
And it plays more than just NES games.
And, like, awesome. Looking back on it now, too, it's so antiquated. Like, I'm like, why did we bother? We put a piece of wood in there with super glue to hold things in place. Like,
I mean, consider this. Consider where we are now in KnowHow. Back then, this is as good as we could do.
This is only three years ago.
This is actually really good. I mean, you know, a lot of hot glue, a couple of different components. Today, it would be, well, we're going to custom solder our connectors, and we're going to 3D print a case.
Exactly.
We can do that now.
And that's where we're going to get to. But, yeah, and for anyone who thinks that I sacrificed a working NES, I did not. No. This was just a case that a friend gave me. There were no working parts inside of it. So, I mean, I do regret kind of cutting this part out for the HDMI power and Ethernet, and then having to screw it in to hold it here. And so it's just not an elegant solution to...
Yeah, but once the case is on top, you don't know any of that.
That's right.
I mean,
it's fine.
Oh, and by the way, sometimes what you have to do is you have to take out the Pi and you have to blow on it and put it back in.
Good. As it should be.
My favorite part of this project, though, or like the hardest part, the part that I'm most proud of, was this little breakout board that hooked into the power and reset button, which will... It was complicated because you don't want to just turn off the Pi.
Right.
You want it to go back out
to the menu. Is that it to do
a shutdown sequence.
Oh.
Yeah, but especially on this original, if you just shut it off, you had like a 50-50 chance that you were going to corrupt the storage. And if you corrupted the storage, you basically have to start over.
Yeah. So the power button, when you trigger it, it doesn't just cut power entirely. It initiates the shutdown sequence. What does the reset button do?
The reset sends another signal that then tells the Raspberry Pi to just reset itself. Like, it doesn't cut power or anything because that would be bad.
Right.
This was an actual a special board that he had to get and then assemble, which triggers the Pi to the kill. Mm-hmm. So it's basically shut down safely all the things and then disconnect power.
Got it.
Yeah, you don't ever want to just pull power, even on the newer Pis, but still, it was really finicky on the old one.
You don't ever want to do that on the newer Pis? Good information for me to know. Because pretty much, you'll see with the MAME cabinet, when we're done, we hit the power switch on the side. We just go plink.
The newer ones are much more fault tolerant. In the older ones, sometimes you'd corrupt it even if you did shut down safely.
Yeah, that's true.
I mean, because it was, they were still kind of hobbyist boards.
Yeah.
The hardware's gotten a lot better. And, unless you are in the habit of ripping out the power cable.
No, it's
nothing
like that.
In the middle of a write, it's probably not going to corrupt it. Probably.
Yeah, probably, maybe not. You'll be fine. Don't worry about it. What you do is you just make an image of the card that you have in there.
I backed it up. Yeah, I've definitely backed it up.
So. Yeah.
And as we both mentioned, it's now so much easier to reflash that image. I mean, literally you download the latest, you write it to an SD card, you plug it into the Pi, you're done.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But this was my example of what I did with my first Raspberry Pi MAME project. But you went to the next level and went all out on your setup. And I have a cut down video from Screensavers of just how you went through that process. So
I remember when.
Yes, almost a year in the
Beautiful.
Making.
Beautiful. Tell us how the genesis of this project.
Well, I can't remember the episode exactly, but it was an episode of Twig almost a year ago. I think the title is Aaron's Arcade, because Newcomb was on.
Yeah, yeah.
And he brought in his own bar top arcade machine and showed it off. And, he had built it. Aaron's a maker. He likes to tweak, all these things and make it to his own specifications.
And you wanted to do it, I remember.
I made a random offhanded comment during the show, man, I've always wanted one of those things. Someday maybe I'll do it. Well, a woodworker fan of the network, Diami Palotki from the East Coast, reached out to me shortly after, and he was like, hey, I work with wood, and I'd be happy to work with you on this project. I will do it, if you're interested. And, what am I going to say? No, I'm not interested in getting an arcade.
He did it. Look at the inlay. This is a beautiful kind of bird's eye maple with incredible grain.
Excellent finish. The finish quality is super shiny, super slick.
So tell us a little bit about the insides here.
Well, we've got a Raspberry 2 powering all of this.
Okay. And that's enough power for this.
Yeah, and it's running RetroPie, which is basically a system image that Aaron Newcomb, I've spent some time with Aaron Newcomb a couple of days ago once we finally got this in-house. And Aaron and I just kind of, popped the machine upside down and really got to the cables. There it is all sprawled out on the table, actually. Everything before we got started. You can see the controls
underneath.
You can
order those all online?
I ordered
the switches.
The buttons, the U-Track roller pad. Got that off of eBay, got a few things off of Amazon, got a monitor off of Amazon, pieced it all together. I probably spent close to around $450 on parts.
We had a MAME machine when we first started in the studio 5 years ago that was powered by a Mac Mini. The Mini alone would have cost more than that.
Right, yes.
So that's a pretty good price.
I mean, thinking about it, just the Pi itself, right? Like the Raspberry Pi, what is it,
$35? Yeah.
And this is the Raspberry Pi 2. Of course, this is a newer version now. And if I want
to... You could upgrade it for $35.
I could upgrade
it,
and that gives me Bluetooth. And that might be great for external Bluetooth controllers.
I love how this is all mounted. Look at that. It's
beautiful. So, that's the speaker, basically a desktop speaker that was taken apart. Diami took it apart and, sealed the speakers to the grills on the wood.
We go. How come you're beating me already? Oh, wait.
Well, I think it's the... Okay. There we go.
All right. We don't need to know how to play.
The how to play. There's
how
a lot
many
of
games?
Wholesome games.
How many games are there?
Good question. Let's see
it goes
here.
Forever.
There is a way to... Oh, man. I can't remember, but it's a couple thousand, I think. I can go, and skip between...
Oh, look, by category.
Atari 2600. Of course...
Oh, my gosh. All Dreamcast. Wait a minute. Go back. That's my game. That's my game.
Yeah, we don't really have
anything. We don't have any GameCast games.
But I suppose it's capable.
I guess so. Look at that.
Anyways.
That was my favorite thing. My son asked the other day, who do we give our Dreamcast to, and can we get it back? So that was a long time ago.
Yeah. You have to go on eBay for that, I have a feeling.
Yeah. Yeah. It was running Windows CE, I believe, on the Dreamcast.
Pretty fantastic. I do want to put some LEDs in here and in here to kind of light them up a little bit.
Not done.
So, you know, I've got ideas for projects of how to kind of improve it over time.
The yellow gold MAME cabinet, yes. Thanks to Instructables and Diami Plotkey and Aaron Newcomb, who did a great job. Yeah.
He was here for a solid day, you know, a couple of days ago.
Yeah, he loves doing this stuff.
Oh, yeah. I mean, you know, he's a maker at heart, so.
Very nice.
Enjoys it.
We're going to get back to that build in just a bit, but first we want to go ahead and thank a sponsor of this episode of KnowHow. And when you think of KnowHow, you got to be thinking of iFixit, because they get us. They understand the generation of makers. They understand the DIYers, the people who like to take things apart, make them better, and then put them back together. Now, to be able to do that, it means you need the right tools. It means you need the right parts, and you need the information. You need thousands of free step-by-step repair guides so that you can get in and get out and make everything look as good as it possibly can, which is why we're so happy to have iFixit as a sponsor of KnowHow. Now, it's got to start not just with the parts, not just with the tools, but the fact that iFixit gets us. They understand the way we think. They understand the way that we work. That's why they give us more than 22,000 free repair guides, 90,000 troubleshooting solutions, and the good people at iFixit are experts in consumer electronics repair, so they're always trying to add to that corpus of knowledge. iFixit provides you all the repair knowledge that you need for free. They also sell a wide array of parts and tools to help you get the job done. They know what they're doing, so they built a toolkit that they would want to use, and that's the ProTech toolkit. Now, they've revamped this. It's completely reimagined. It's just as rugged and portable as before, but now it includes more. It's got a durable canvas case. It's got hand-selected high-quality bits. They now have a 64-bit driver kit instead of a 54-bit driver kit, custom anodized aluminum driver handles, precision ESD-safe tweezers, a pair of reverse tweezers, a wide variety of plastic opening tools and picks to safely work on tablets and smartphones, even suction cups. I used this when I took apart Leo's studio, his Surface Studio. That's an expensive piece of hardware. I didn't want to mar the surface. I didn't want to break anything by prying it open. So I went to iFixit. Their repair guide told me the safe way to tear it down, and it told me exactly which tools in my kit I should use to remove the bottom with, say, suction cups, and which drivers to use so I don't strip out screws. Folks, this is your best friend if you're looking to upgrade, if you're looking to fix, or if you're just looking to figure out how something works. Now, this ProTech toolkit is the last precision toolkit that you'll ever need, which is why iFixit guarantees it for a lifetime. The people at iFixit.com never stop repairing, and with this toolkit under your belt, you won't either. Head over to iFixit.com/twit. That's iFixit.com/twit, and use the code KNOWHOW at checkout to save $5 on your purchase of $10 or more. Even if you don't buy anything, you can still use their free repair guides, troubleshooting answer forms, and other educational resources on their website anytime your tech has an accident. Again, that's iFixit.com/twit. And we thank iFixit for their support of KnowHow.
All right, guys, so we got to do it here.
Yeah.
Now,
what?
We are going to put in a little something something. There's going to be links inside of our show notes so that mm-hmm. I can go back to the original Raspi episode where right. we did MAME, and then also to the update that you did, which was, as you said, it was a little disappointing because it was not nearly as difficult as it was originally.
Yeah, no, it wasn't really worth doing a video. You just go to the RetroPie website.
Download
the image. Put it on the SD card, plug it into the Raspberry Pi, and then load your ROMs onto a USB. Plug the USB into the Raspberry Pi. Pretty much all you have to do.
All right. Well, I'm going to let the two of you talk about the intricacies of creating something like this. I'm actually going to go over here.
What?
Just
where
you just.
What's that behind? What do you know? An arcade machine appeared behind
How about
Bryan
that?
There.
Ah. Great. So, Jason, what am I looking at here?
Well, so okay, so. Just to kind of back up a little bit, this is the arcade cabinet that Diami Palotki, a woodworker on the East Coast, made for me. He actually hosts his own woodworking podcast, by the way. It's called Modern Woodworking Podcast. So you should check that out if you like the design of it. He was basically running off of plans that Aaron Newcomb had given. They're posted on instructables.com. If you search for two-player bar top arcade machine, you'll find it there.
This is so
and then they
awesome.
Were modified. So you can see in the middle, there's a little trackball. I felt like that was necessary because one of my all-time favorite games is Marble Madness.
So you had to have the ball.
Yeah, although that tacked on an additional almost $100 to the project for just Whoa. The trackball. But Diami said, I could totally make, you know, modify the plans to make room for it and everything. And I'm really happy I did that because it actually, what I've noticed is that the trackball is really good for driving games.
Okay, yeah.
In a driving game, normally you'd have a steering wheel and it has variation of degrees. And you can mimic that with a trackball by rolling back and forth. So a little bit, and now you're turning a lot and all that kind of stuff in a better way than you can with the hand, with just the normal sticks.
Okay.
And so not only is it good for trackball games, it's also very good for racing games.
That's neat. Yeah, because with my project, you know, I was just using an NES controller. So you're kind of limited to just a few console games. But with this, you've got the joystick, you've got the buttons. So I'm guessing like fighting games, you could do pretty well.
Oh, yeah, because I got the six rows of buttons and everything that usually maps out really well.
Yeah. And then you were saying that the only downside is that I guess the speakers are on it, but you have to like adjust the volume from inside.
Yeah, so you can see the speaker grills right there. On the inside in the back is where, so basically those speakers, and I think you had this in the little cut down, those speakers were actually like desktop speakers for a computer or whatever that Diami kind of extracted and implanted into the back of that. So the little volume knob is kind of part of one of those speaker enclosures, and it's on the inside of the lid. Anytime I want to turn up or down the volume, I have to take off the back lid. It's not the end of the world, but it'd be nice to have it embedded on the side or something like that. Well, a little bit more easily accessible.
What I thought was smart with the back lid, though, that Diami did was with the magnetic, so you don't have to like unscrew anything. So you just push it up and then it stays there.
It's got a lip up on the top that you kind of slide it in, and then down at the bottom as you set it in, the magnet grabs it.
Pretty cool. Yeah. So since you've had this machine, what kind of, have you done mods? Have you upgraded it?
Yeah, so when I originally got it, I put in the Raspberry Pi 2. I want to say at the time that was the latest one.
Yeah.
And I ordered it, and you know, the turnaround for this, it took a while because Diami's got a life outside of making a free arcade cabinet for me. It
that
was
woodwork
crazy looks that he did
so
that.
Nice too.
Oh, he did a fantastic job. I'm so honored that he wanted to do that, and it was really great that he did that. But it had the Raspberry Pi. You're gonna be careful you don't move that off the counter.
Oh, sorry.
No, I'm just protecting my baby.
I'm excited.
It had the Pi 2 inside initially, and then the Pi 3 happened. And of course, the Pi 3 brings Bluetooth support
and Wi-Fi,
and it brings Wi-Fi support, and you know, updating things. You require an internet connection and kind of plugging in Ethernet on this thing where I have it positioned at the house. Mm-hmm. It doesn't have an Ethernet drop, so it just made sense. Like what? $35. $35 to like upgrade the computer. And what do you end up then with? Mm-hmm. Another Pi to do something else with.
Exactly. And so when you upgraded to the next Pi, did you have to change the image on the SD card, or did you just pop it out and then put it in the new one and you're good to go?
I literally took the SD card out of the old one, put it in the new one, fired it up, and I was right back where I needed to be. It was seamless.
Yeah, because I mean, the 2 is powerful enough to run all these arcade games. Mm-hmm. Really, the issues I've run into have been, it's more on the emulator side if a game doesn't run well. Like, there's Star Fox that doesn't run very well because that required, like, an FX NES chip or whatever.
Oh, man, I wish they'd figure that one out.
I know, I love Star Fox. But what I've noticed with the 3 is that things are a lot more snappy. Like, it is a pretty big jump from the 2 to the 3. So for $35, if you're going to upgrade your system, that's not bad.
No, not bad at all. Especially when you consider that with the 2, if I wanted to add Bluetooth support and I wanted to add Wi-Fi support, those are each, you know, $10, $15 little additions.
Right.
So then you add that up and it's kind of a no-brainer. I might as well just get the new one. Mm-hmm. Then I've got a second one to do something fun with. What is it? I don't know. You know, you can use your imagination and just come up with something neat because you've got an extra computer, basically.
Yeah, totally. So if you were going to do anything different to this machine, would you, or are you pretty satisfied with the way it is?
Well, I'm very satisfied with the way it is. Couple of things I would do. You can see down at the bottom lip there with the Dell logo. I would love to cover that up somehow. It's kind of, I mean, it's that way because that's where the power buttons and everything for the monitor are. So there isn't a whole lot that I can do with that. Like, I can't magically.
How do I get back out to the menu?
What's that?
How do I get back out to the menu?
Press the coin and the player at the same time.
So that's like start select.
And that takes you. Yeah.
That is so well thought out. I mean, I love the details on this. Everything from the cabinet to, I mean, the controls really feel like the old arcade game.
Yeah. Well, and then just navigating the menu system, you've got all the album art for the games.
So that's another thing that we should definitely talk about. Mm-hmm. So there's Scraper inside RetroPie. And Scraper, what does that do? That accesses databases that basically it takes a look at the files that you have, the ROM files that you have on your storage, mm-hmm. and then it compares it against a database. And if it matches up perfectly, it downloads album art or, you know, the cover art, or in some cases it downloads like a picture of an old promotional you know, clipping from the 80s of that arcade game, you know, from a magazine or whatever. Mm-hmm. And there's a scraper that's built into the menu system of RetroPie that's pretty good. It has a couple of different databases that you can pull from. It's really slow.
Ah, yeah.
So it's a set it and wait overnight
thing. And I noticed it's finicky if you have a ROM that kind of has a weird name to it. All these completely legally obtained ROMs that I've I have, sometimes they have weird names on them and they don't pop up right. Like or you have like kind of a generic game like Donkey Kong where there's a bunch of them and sometimes it'll grab like the wrong Donkey Kong game.
Yep, Donkey Kong 3.
But no, you were saying there's like a deep scraper.
Yes, so there is another option, and really you can only get to it. You can't get to it through the main menu system. You have to actually quit out of emulation station, which is kind of the front end. You go to a command line, and I did it from my Mac, kind of SSHing into the computer over my network. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, it was relatively easy to do. But you can run the setup and the configuration tools there. I think, actually, you can also get to this menu from the interface.
Back out of the
if you go to, like,
station.
Configuration tools, that'll jump you into it. Mm-hmm. And then there is a scraper that's built into that kind of deeper menu by Steven Self. Hmm. And it's faster. It pulls from more databases, and it has a higher match rate, I've noticed. It actually matches the MD5 kind of hash from the ROMs as opposed to, like, just straight file names or whatever. You can also tell it how you want that to present on the UI side of things. Do you want it to show the fact that it's a United States version, you know, 5 hack, blah, blah, blah? Or do you just only want it to ever say Donkey Kong?
Right.
You know, just the title and keep it clean. And so that's a really good option that's kind of buried deep. And I actually didn't find that for this. I found this for my other project, which we'll talk about in a few.
Right, right. So are you having fun over there, Padre? What just happened to you? Oh,
is this Moonlander?
It kind of blew up.
It kind of blew up over
there? I don't
want to
play that game anymore.
Welcome to emulation when you've got all these games. It's like every game lasts like a minute. And you're like, all right, what's the next one? That's all the time I have for that.
You have thousands to choose from. Like, how many games would you say you have on there?
Oh, I don't
my goodness.
Yeah, it's too
honestly,
many to count.
I don't know.
Oh, I, some
you know,
of
I've got
these,
a decent
oh my
amount
gosh,
of systems
this is like
on
the golden days.
I've got enough.
Yeah, enough. And there's a lot of those games that to be properly played, you need like a joystick and the buttons and things like that.
It certainly helps with the illusion, and it's the right way to play the arcade games. You know what I mean? Like, I remember when emulation first started becoming a thing, or when I first recognized and understood it, like late 90s, early 2000s. I was like, wait a minute, I could use my computer to play all these arcade games? Like, 12-year-old me would be, you know, screaming and jumping at the chance. So, of course, I'm going to try this out. And, you know, it looks the same. It sounds the same. But it's not the same play experience because you don't have the kind of cabinet. You don't have the nice controls and the buttons that you can slap instead of, like, tapping with your thumb. It totally transforms the experience. It's the right way to do it.
Yeah.
So it's pretty cool. Some other changes. You asked me about changes or whatever. I want to put LED in the trackball. There's a little
hole. Oh, me and
Padre
can help you out with that. If there's anything we know how to do, is put LEDs on stuff.
Excellent. Ooh, nice. Punch out. The arcade punch out.
Yeah, no, this is not the Nintendo version. This is the arcade version.
The arcade version, which I played a lot.
I forgot what the buttons are, though.
At my roller skating rink as a kid. Anyways, so LEDs in the trackball, and I would love help on that. Also, LEDs.
How do I put my guard up?
The coin insert, which you can hardly see, it's down underneath on the side where the player buttons are. There's
Jason,
some fake
I don't know
coin
what the
inserts
buttons
that
are.
Yami put in there. They're not real, but there's a place for you to feed an LED light into them so that they would light up. I would love to do that too. So you turn on the power and all this stuff lights up.
Yeah, those would be some nice little touches to it.
Yeah, another thing that I'm considering is a different front end. So we talk a lot about RetroPie when you're talking about Raspberry Pi and retro gaming. Mm-hmm. There are other front ends, and one front end that somebody showed me, and this is in the doc if we want to take a look at it, Kara, is called Attract Mode. Huh. And it's Attract Mode, from what I understand, was designed especially for arcade cabinets.
Okay.
And so it's a much more graphically kind of intense experience, but you get like full motion video on all the games as you're kind of selecting them as things go by. I think, so they have all different types of front ends. So this is just one type of front end that you could do.
That side slider it has.
Yeah, exactly. It's just a lot more graphical. You know, it's kind of like for the gaming fan. It's not just an endless list of games. It really kind of takes the qualities, this like visual element of what gamers love about, you know, the whole experience of gaming, and not mm-hmm. just I have all these games, but
right. Well, that's part of the appeal of like an arcade. When you would walk into an arcade, you'd see it would just be kind of a visual, I don't know, explosion or something.
Yeah,
you know?
Totally. And I don't know, you know, when you're thumbing through these games, the thing about having a MAME cabinet like this is that you have this large list of games, and it's almost like you get numb to the fact that you have all these games. It's really hard to pick one. Mm-hmm. It's really hard to, like, I feel like gaming, but you don't know what you feel like because you literally have so many choices.
Almost overwhelmed.
You get overwhelmed. So you get something like that, and it mm-hmm. gives you a little bit of help. It's like, I wouldn't have thought of playing Metal Slug, but looking at that little gameplay,
game.
That looks like a lot of fun.
Oh, man.
Pretty
cool.
That's a hard game, Padre. Don't
well, I forgot which button it was. I'm like, I know one of these is guard.
Yeah, well, you remember on the big arcade version of that, there was a giant.
Yeah.
I think it was
punch.
An uppercut button or punch or KO. No, it was a KO button. So that when you had the KO lineup, you went bam.
This was lighting up. I'm like, okay, where's the KO button?
Yeah. So anyways, I might at some point do Attract Mode and see what that's all about for the arcade, Kevin.
Okay.
Let's step away from KnowHow for a bit and talk about something a bit more pressing. What are you going to get for that someone special in your life this Valentine's Day? It's not easy, is it? Flowers? Well, that's a good start. Chocolates, been there, done that. A romantic dinner, sure, that's a nice touch. But none of those things are really something special for that someone who's really special. But what if you could give a gift that isn't just a treat for the senses, but for the mind? I mean, you are a geek, right? I mean, you love knowledge, and your gift needs to say as much about you as it does about that special someone. That's why we're so happy to have 23andMe as a sponsor of KnowHow. 23andMe is the online, personalized genetic service named after the 23 pairs of chromosomes found in your DNA. With their genetic report, you can reach back more than 500 years and across 31 worldwide population centers to trace your ancestry to maternal and paternal haplogroups. Their ancestry service lets you track your genetics through history, letting you connect to people who share your DNA, even let you see how much Neanderthal DNA you've inherited. You can see how your DNA relates to caffeine consumption, lactose intolerance, muscle type, and more. It's a cornucopia of knowledge, real knowledge, that has real-world applications, all for the taking. Simply provide 23andMe with a saliva sample in one of their testing kits, mail it back to the lab, and in no time at all, you'll unlock the vault of information that is your genetics. With over 65 genetic reports, your loved one will be sure to fall in love with their genetics at 23andMe. Just go to 23andme.com today. Buy before Valentine's Day to get $20 off. That's 23andme.com. 23andme.com. And we thank 23andMe for their support of KnowHow.
We come back to this discussion.
Back to Earth.
This is back to Earth. Oh, okay, I got to tell you. You know, we had that the Mac Mini in the arcade cabinet, which actually went to Smitty. So Smitty's got that in his...
Oh, yeah. That thing was fantastic.
So many hours of Gauntlet that we played. And then the Michael Jackson game we played a lot of, too. Yeah,
Moonwalker. But I mean, the thing is, this is better.
Wow.
I like that. But the Mac Mini was a pain to configure.
Oh, yeah. There is that, yes.
And, you know, the cabinet is cool, but I can't put that in many places. I don't have space. I would have space for something like this.
Yeah. That's kind of the beauty of that size is that, and you know, the way it ended up working out at our house, it was actually totally perfect. We had this place in our den that has this, it's like this little nook that has that had a sink and a small counter. And the sink, we never once even used the sink. We had it totally, you know, undone underneath. So it was this like dead corner of our house. perfect size. Like, I basically removed the sink, put that over the hole on the countertop, and it's the right size. It's the right height for an arcade cabinet.
That's perfect.
Like, it was like it was meant to be.
So cool.
The reason why we're doing this episode is because we want to tease them. We want them to know that we are actually going to do detailed write-ups of this. It's not just going to be the work that we've done in the past. We are working on a few things. We're creating a 3D printed case for you because you've got a free pie now.
Well, yeah. So I put the three there, and then I have the two that used to be there in this bag, and I have a little SD or a little card in there. What is it? It's 32 gig. Not
oh,
huge,
just 32 gigs. No big deal.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, when
how far we've
games,
come. How far we've
each
come.
Of these games is maybe a couple megabytes.
I still have a 512 megabyte card, which back in the day was like, oh, this is huge. Oh, my goodness. What am I going to do with
I'm
this?
I'm not going to fill this ever. So I've got this too, and I was like, well, you know what? Sometimes, like, that is great. The arcade cabinet is awesome. It's best for arcade games because that's what it's designed, what those arcade games were designed for. You can play console games on there. You could play Super Nintendo, Genesis, NES, whatever, and it's fine.
Right.
But it's not the way you would have played it back in the day, right? So I was like, okay, well, I've got this extra one. Why don't I make this my console, and that's my arcade? And so, you know, I've got the consoles on here, essentially. Great. I had to get a Bluetooth adapter. Why?
Oh.
Two of these suckers.
Oh.
These
are the
8-bit do. Is that how you say it? 8-bit
do. Yeah, sure. The kids are saying that.
Yeah, it sounds about right.
It's the SFC30 gamepad. It's a Bluetooth, wireless SNES replica. And it actually does really well.
How much are those?
These, how much were these? I want to say they were like 35 a piece.
Okay, that sounds about right. Like, I cheaped out when I first did my project, and I got the USB wired ones. These are like $10, but they feel like $10 too. They're kind of chintzy.
SFC 30. Yeah, I'm pretty sure that they are. Well, Newegg has it for like $28.
Now, I do want to say I'm glad you brought that up because I've been working on this for a while. Now, this was, I'm going to put it into Jason's product shot. So this is just a Raspi. This is the 7-inch touchscreen connected to a Raspberry Pi 3. So there actually is a Raspi on the back here. Right now I'm running Open Source Media Center, OSMC, but I'm going to be running RetroPie on this, and I'm actually redesigning my case. So the whole idea is this can be strapped to the back of like the headrest on a seat. And then if you add controllers to it, suddenly your kids have an arcade set up in the back. So, you know.
My kids? Wait a minute, you're giving this to me?
I
don't have to think I need another arcade.
Your kids.
You can have it on video. He's giving it to you.
I don't
you.
Need another arcade.
What I really mean is when I'm taking a long drive, I can go into the back seat and I can start playing
video
games.
So by your kids, you mean you.
Yeah, he's a big kid.
I am a huge kid.
I don't fault you for that at all.
But, you know,
that's a great idea.
What I love about this is, especially with the advent of 3D printers, it really does give you so many options.
Yeah.
I actually can print out something that looks like a mini NES. And you can put a Raspi in there, and it plays way more games than the official mini NES. How much does that cost? That's like $150, was that?
Whoa, the NES Classic?
Right.
$60.
Oh, this is a $60
But it's limited
one?
To 30 games.
30 games.
Although there have been people who have figured out how to very easily hack into it and just load all the NES games on it.
Anything you
want. So, I mean, is it easier to get your hands on one and then hack it and put the games on it? Maybe, but you could also get a Raspberry Pi and put all the games on that too. And then, Kara, I think there's a link in the doc for a NES. If you have a 3D printer, you can print out a case for your Raspberry Pi that looks identical to pretty much the NES Classic. This one, this guy did, I forget. Can you read? Do you know what the name is on in this one? It's like Daft Mike or something like that. He did a really good job on this one, though.
That's nice.
And this one, he went so far as to make an NFC tag
on
certain cartridges. So you put it into the case, and it'll pull up that game.
Aww.
Which is a little like beyond what I would do.
That's overkill. No. But I appreciate the attention to detail.
I mean, that is way overkill. That's way more than you need, and now I want that.
But you can get this kit, 3D print all the parts, and then also the power button with a red LED will work just the same way it does on my awesome. Real console or my old Nintendo console.
Yeah. So I think, you know, what we want to leave the audience with is, if there are any projects here that you really, really like, if you want to see more about Jason's arcade cabinet, and which, by the way, we are going to KnowHowify because he wants LEDs all over that, and you know we're really good at LEDs.
Yeah.
That's what we do. Or if you want to see what I'm going to be doing with my little touchscreen, or if you want to see what Bryan's doing with his next version of his RetroPie, I mean, you got to stay tuned. And make sure to join our Google Plus group and tell us what you want, because we want to form the episode after what you're longing for.
That's right. That's right. So I guess that kind of wraps everything up for this episode. Yeah.
Jason, thank you so very much. I mean, not just for the time I spent remembering how bad I am at arcade games.
You suddenly pictured yourself in a dark,
dropping quarters into endless.
Yeah. You're going to leave the arcade,
hearing Eye
right?
of the Tiger on the speakers.
Ooh, or wow. Rush.
Yeah,
or
Rush.
Rush. Well, yeah, see, that was the thing. I had my Sony Walkman with Rush.
I got to figure that part out. We need to get a Sony Walkman for people who are playing it to wear.
There are people out there who don't know what a Walkman is. That's the scary thing. The kids I see every day, because I live at a school, they've never known an arcade. They don't know what an arcade is. Mm-hmm. Because, you play video game? You go someplace
to
play video
games? Wait, you had to
games?
Go somewhere and put quarters
into
a machine?
I've got it on my phone. There was something about, and I know this is total nostalgia, but there was something about that. Like going to a movie theater where they had an attached arcade and not seeing a movie because you spent all your time in the arcade.
And I mean, they still do. Arcades now are like when you go to like a bowling alley they're less arcades in the sense of here's a stand-up game that's fun to play. And they're more like here's a way that you can get tickets that are actually worth less than a penny. Yeah. You know what I mean? And redeem it for a Tootsie Roll. Yeah.
Skee-ball.
Which, I mean, don't get me wrong. Kids it's fun, but it's just different. It's not the same thing. It doesn't translate the same. I could spend an entire afternoon in an arcade that had nothing but hundreds of rows.
Well, I think it just means we have to do a KnowHow where we go to Japan. Because isn't that where you can go?
Oh, okay, let's do that.
We'll just do a travel trip where we go and we check out arcades.
Road trip! Jason, if you could please, I mean, of course they know already, but if you could please tell them where they can find you, where they can find your work, where they can find your shows here on Twitch.
Do Tech News Today, of course, every weekday, twit.tv/TNT with Megan Maroney, do All About Android every Tuesday. We have a great time, Ron, Flo, and myself. Occasionally you're on. We have to have you back, by the way. Android App Arena, all over the network, sometimes on new screensavers and sometimes on KnowHow. Just, you know, twit.tv. I'm Jason Howell on Twitter. That's about all you need to know.
Thank you for coming on. And you know what? Anytime I get a chance to have you back on the show, it's kind of fun. It really is, because, I mean, normally I'm stuck with a level of conversation that, you know.
Yeah, I get it.
Well, shiny lights. You're going to leave the arcade, right? You're just, that's going to stay here?
That's my surprise to you, Bryan. I'm not taking it home.
Yes. but don't forget, folks, that you're going to find everything in the show notes. And actually, this is a very important episode because we didn't really do how-to here. We're going to link up to everything. If you want instructions for how he did his official original MAME machine, if you want to see the update, if you want to see the links to the downloads, if you want to see the bill of materials that Jason had from his episode, you're going to find them in the KnowHow show notes. And Bryan, where do we put those?
Where we usually put them, at twit.tv/KH. And if you haven't already, you'll want to subscribe because we'll be doing a follow-up episode where we have a case for our Raspberry Pi 3. We'll have to decide if it's going to be in the NES case or something more elaborate, but in the future we will have that. So, but that's not the only place.
No, you're going to want to follow us on the socials. I mentioned this before. Go to Google Plus and look for KnowHow. There's this very short approval process just so we can keep out all the spam accounts. But once you're in, you get access to over 11,000, almost 11,000 Kitas. That's our know-it-alls. These are people who are experts or beginners or intermediate in the DIY maker arena. You can ask questions, you can answer questions, you can share your knowledge, or you could get an idea for the next great project. Also, don't forget that if you ask questions or leave videos and pictures and descriptions of your projects, it may make it into one of the feedback episodes of KnowHow. That's also the place you want to go if you want to tell us what kind of RetroPie you want to see. We'll create what you want.
That's right. And usually it's a place where people show us up with their projects. Yes, like I'm fairly like certain that. After I did my NES project the first time, somebody did like a way better job.
Well, like on the Groduino that we did, someone posted, I did this a couple years ago and it was a fantastic project with great coding. I'm like, okay, no.
Fine. Share your projects.
Fair do.
That's great. Great.
But if you we like it. We love it. We really do.
Yeah, I love it. But if you want to see what we're doing outside of KnowHow or what might be coming up on a future episode, you're going to want to follow me or Padre, I guess.
Maybe.
On Twitter. I'm at @cranky_hippo.
And I am at @PadreSJ. And our director today is not...
Caracol.
Is not, what is it, Jimmy Gimble? It's Kara Cole. Kara, where do people find you?
Oh, I'm always behind the scenes here at the Twit Network. I'm an engineer. I produce the screensavers. I TD occasionally. And you can follow me on Twitter at Kara080.
She doesn't post a lot, though, so don't worry about getting spammed.
I don't tweet too much, so I won't be bombarding you with annoying. I mostly retweet.
What we need to do is we need to make sure that she has more followers than all the other engineers here, just so she could walk by them.
I think I have like 400. Yeah. But hey, when I started like a year ago, I only had 20.
Yeah.
So. I will say we should be very proud because I think we got at least 5 giggles out of Kara.
Oh,
right,
yes.
Throughout the show.
You could hear them. There was snarks.
Mm-hmm. I always
That's what Jason works for.
I don't know, though. I feel like
Jason the giggle.
It got balanced out, though, because there was like 5 giggles and like 10 sighs.
Yeah. A couple yawns. No.
Until next time, I am Father Robert Palliser.
I'm Bryan Burnett.
And that's Jason Howell.
Hey. Mm-hmm.
And now that you know how.
Get gaming. Go build a Raspberry Pi thing.
Go game it.
I never even got to play this.
I know.
Bring it up.
What did I even use this for?
Woo! Woo!